on into the living room. Well, my name is Gretchen, and welcome to Deere Wiman. The house that we're going to go through today was built in 1872 by Charles Deere, John Deere's son. He was the only son of John Deere's that lived to adulthood. So naturally, he became president of Deere & Company when John died. But when he built this house, he was vice president at Deere. And he had a wife and two young daughters. Now let's talk a little bit about John Deere first. John Deere, when I ask kids and adults, what did John invent? The usual answer is what? The tractor. And that's incorrect because in fact, John Deere and Charles Deere never saw a tractor their entire life.
What?
Everything was horse-drawn equipment. And so John invented a plow that looked like this. Now, John was a blacksmith. Here's a painting of what John looked like, supposedly, and working in his blacksmith shop in Grandy Tour. He would take iron and make tools and horseshoes. The trunk you have, there is a horseshoe in there, so you'll be able to see what cast iron looks like. It's heavy and it's kind of rough. And so John realized that the problem was that farmers had plows pulled by a horse that was made out of cast iron right here. And here in the Midwest, we have really good dirt. It's rich, good crops can grow in it. And so John realized that that cast iron would slice into the nice moist dirt and it would stick to the plowshare. And that would really slow down the farmer. So John invented a plowshare made out of stainless steel, polished, so it was nice and shiny. That's the same material that you'd find in a sewing needle. And when that sliced into the earth, it would come right out clean, self-scouring. And so no dirt stuck to that.
Awesome.
Now, when he came to Moline, moved his business to Moline, it was with his wife and children. And Charles was one of those. He grew up, went to work for his father, and eventually became vice president. And that's when he built the house that we're in right now for his wife and two daughters. Now, the house that we're in has changed a lot. Here's an early picture of the house. In 1872, it was designed by William LeBaron Jenney, a real famous architect out of Chicago. And why do we call this a Victorian style home? Well, this whole period of history from the 1840s until the early 1900s, we call the Victorian era after Queen Victoria of England. She never visited the United States, but even here in the United States, she had kind of celebrity status. And so people wanted to copy the popular architecture and dress and music of the day. And so that's why we call this Victorian. But look at the steep pitched roof, because next I want to show you the house about 1900. So almost 30 years after the first one. Can you see the changes between the two pictures?
Wow.
The roof is different. There's been a change to this side of the house. The front porch has moved out and the pillars are different. They've changed the number of windows and they added a second tower right here. And here you can see there's a lot of change between the two. Why would you change the exterior of the house?
I don't know.
Two reasons. One is you wanted to keep up with what was in style. And this style of architecture was more in style by 1900. Also, we know that there was a fire way up here on the third floor back in 1899. And that fire damaged the roof. And I think Charles thought, if we've got to rebuild the roof, we might as well update it to a more current style. So this is how it looked in 1900 with some new additions. It's still wood-sided like the old picture, but then we look at the house today and we can see another different look. They covered over the wood siding with stucco, which kind of looks like cement on the outside of the house. They did some remodeling here again. They screened in the front porch. They made a change here by adding a chimney for a new fireplace and took out this old chimney. So lots of changes. One thing that I like that stayed the same is look at how the path, the sidewalk crosses in front of all the houses. So the sidewalk's still in the same spot. Now, we're gonna come inside the house and I'll let you go ahead and scan the room and show them the great big living room. That went right across here.
No way.
And the fireplace behind me, it didn't exist when the house was built. Instead, right here on this wall, there were two fireplaces back to back, one in each room.
That's insane.
We're lucky that we have two photographs that show us the two rooms that were here. These pictures were taken about 1900. And what's great about them is I can see what's changed and what stayed the same. For example, from these rooms to the room today, the ceiling is different and the walls are different. We know that they took out this dividing wall with the two fireplaces and built the new fireplace here on the exterior wall. Now I look at these and I realize this room looks kind of like a ladies' room, and it was Mrs. Deere's parlor. This was more the family room. And what I like about these two pictures is we've looked at these and found that some of the furnishings that we have, we still can find them in the pictures.
What?
For example, the painting that hung on this wall that's gone now, it's the one right above the fireplace. So I've got a math question for you that I always ask. Here we've got a 1900 photograph with that painting in it. And now it's 2021 and that painting is still here. So is that painting less than greater than or equal to 121 years. Give you a minute to think about that. We know it's not less than 121 years because it's been here for 121 years. Is it equal to 121 years old? It might be, because maybe it was brand new in this photograph. And we definitely know that it could be greater than 121 years because we aren't sure how long it was here. Now, in this picture, this fireplace mantle, when they took the wall out and had to get rid of both of those fireplaces, they must have really liked this one because they moved it up to the second floor and reinstalled it in a guest room. So they recycled things back then sometimes too. What I like to ask is, do you know exactly what I mean when I say a mantle? Well, to me, a mantle is like a piece of furniture attached to the wall. It usually has a shelf, and it can be made out of different things. Wood, stone, brick, and it surrounds the fireplace opening. So those of you that have a fireplace at home, you can go home and say, oh, this is the mantle.
Dude.
But this mantle in this picture, notice how it goes from the floor almost to the ceiling. Now, do any of you have a library this big at your house? Probably not, but I bet that there's a bookshelf somewhere in your house with books in it. But I think how big this library is shows us that the family loved to read, but that also the family was pretty wealthy.
Cha-ching.
Because Charles Deere, he could check books out of the Moline Public Library just like everybody else. But he was wealthy enough he could have his own library right here at home. Now think about books. Today, how do we find out about what's going on in the world? Mostly from our cell phones and the internet. Back in Charles Deere's day, to find out what was going on in the world, you pretty much had to read it from something written, like a book, a letter, a newspaper, or be told it directly to you from another person. So think about how quick we get information today. If something happens in Japan, we can hear about it almost instantly. But back in the early 1900s, Charles Deere traveled to Japan. It took him quite a few weeks to get there by ship and train, but he also wrote a letter to his wife while he was there, and we have that letter. He might have beaten his wife home because that letter had to also travel all that way back to here. And so the speed that we get information today is so much faster. Now, in this room, there's four of something that I think tells us about the people who lived here, and that's the paintings. Here we have Charles Deere above the fireplace, John Deere's son, who built the house. Over here, we have his wife, Mary. And remember, they had two daughters, Anna and Catherine. Now, Anna married a man named William Wiman, and she had two sons, One of which is right up here, Charles Deere Wiman. And next to him is his wife, Patty Wiman. They were the last two people to live in this house. Mrs. Wiman passed away in 1976. A couple other things that I really like in this room, the old photograph from 1900. What's interesting is we can see Charles Deere had a big desk in the room. And we see this carving or this bust right here. And that is in the same spot that it was back in 1900. And what I like about this bust, it was carved in 1886. And it's supposed to look like John Deere. It's a pretty good likeness of him in the face, but John didn't have this hairstyle and he didn't wear a toga. But back in the 1800s, when they carved a statue of you, they wanted you to look like the most famous men of the past. And that was the Romans, who wore togas and had this hairstyle. Now, what I also like about this statue is I know who the artist was that carved it. His name was Leonard Volk. He lived around here in the Quad Cities for a while. He met John, carved his statue. But about 20 years before, a little over 20 years before he met John, he met somebody else really famous in Illinois and carved their statue. And that was Abraham Lincoln. So I think that's cool that Leonard Volk got to meet Abraham Lincoln and John Deere, two of the most famous people that came out of Illinois. One other thing that I like about this room, old picture, is the chandelier. It's gone now. We don't know when or why they took it down, but I think they cut it in half and mounted them on the wall, two wall sconces. So we still have them, but they're just in a little bit different form. They did have a huge pipe organ. They called this area the music room. It was a later addition. And so they had a big pipe organ. You might recognize the porcelain piece by the lamp. That shows up in the old photo of Mary Deere's sitting room. So it was here by 1900. Okay, let's go on into the dining room. Room in this house because it really shows well what was popular during the Victorian era, and that was nature and being outdoors. So they had lots of windows, but when you look around this room, you see signs of nature everywhere. It's all painted all over the wallpaper. Up along the ceiling line, there's carvings that show nature. Up there, you can't probably see them, but they're birds. In another one, there's two big fish. And the third one, there's some rabbits. Can you see the two big fish? They kind of go like, yeah, kind of like horns coming out along the bottom, arcing up. And then if you look at the furniture, you see nature carved into the chairs, the room divider, even the picture frames, and every painting in the room has a nature theme, and the light fixtures even. So everywhere you look, you see signs of nature. The other thing I like about the room is there used to be a little, what they called a conservatory, kind of like a greenhouse that sat right here with a glass dome ceiling. And so they would have had this room packed with plants right next to the dining room that was decorated in nature. But at one point, the family made this into a breakfast room. And what we're going to do next is I'm going to lead you around through what was the butler's pantry. The butler's pantry is where the dishes were kept and washed. All the cooking was done in the basement kitchen beneath us. So everything had to be carried up the back stairs or brought up in the dumbwaiter. Let's go see the dumbwaiter. So if you didn't want to have to haul all that food up and down the back stairs, you could put it on the shelves, push the button, and it would come up or go down. The engine doesn't work anymore for us, so we have to pull the dumbwaiter by hand. Okay, let's go into the pantry. Come on over and see the sink. This is a really cool sink. It's made out of what's called German nickel. It's kind of got some give to it. And the reason they did this is if you were washing glassware and fine china, have you ever dropped a piece, hit the sink, and it shattered? Well, with the water in here and the suds and you were cleaning, if something fell, it wouldn't break. It would have a little more gentle landing to it. So that's why they had this type of sink in their pantry. Now, when you're walking through this house, there's quite a few rooms where you see a little button about this big on the wall. It's not a light switch. It's actually a button to push to call a staff member. They don't work anymore, but this little room here that's an office now was originally the staff room. And so if somebody was on duty, would have been in here when the family was in the house. And if you pushed a button, a bell would ring and a little arrow would flip to which room you were being called to. And so then the staff member could go up the back stairs or go out to the library, wherever he was being called, and find out what the family member needed. Maybe Mr. Deere needed his morning coffee and the newspaper. So he'd push the button in the library and the staff member would know where to go.
Nice.
Okay, we're gonna head up the stairs to the second floor in just a little bit. When we tour the house, we tour the first floor that you've just seen and the second floor where there were four bedrooms, a sitting room, and five bathrooms. And I'll tell you about the bathrooms when we get upstairs. Third floor is where the children's rooms were, a room for a nanny who helped take care of the children, and a couple of other staff bedrooms. We don't open the third floor to the public because that's where I have a work room. We use it for storage and the archives. And then above that is a full attic for where they stored lots of things. So let's go on up the stairs to the second floor. Stairs, the railing's never this low now, and that's because there's building codes today that tell you exactly the height for safety that railings have to be. Back then, they didn't have those building codes, so you could put the railing at whatever height you wanted, and this height is actually more pleasing to the way the stairs is built. And you know what? I find this railing just the right height for me to just rest my hand on. And I found that this works for about any height. I had a high school group one time, and the one student in the group, he was about 6'5". And I said, come over here and stand by the steps. And he came and stood here, big long arms, and his hand just rested right on the railing. So sometimes people will say, oh, they must have been short people back then because the railing's low. They were tall and short just like today. Yes, overall, we've gotten taller over time, but the Deeres were all pretty tall people. Charles Deere, Charles Wiman, they were at least 6 foot or a little over. And Anna, one of their daughters, we have a dress of hers, and I can tell she was about my height. So about 5'8", so not that short. Whereas Queen Victoria that I mentioned earlier, she was, I think, 4'9", which is kind of the average height of a third or fourth grader today. She was a little bitty thing, but her husband was a lot taller. Yeah. So let's look at the first room here. First, at the entrance, you see that picture that we saw downstairs of Mary Deere's sitting room. That's because this is the room that her fireplace mantle was moved to. And since we're doing a camera, you'll get to see one of the bathrooms that we usually can't show people because this carpet is so old and fragile. We don't let people walk on it. But this is one of the bathrooms. And back in 1872, indoor plumbing was found in wealthy homes like this house. And so Charles Deere, when he built the house in 1872, he built it with indoor plumbing. And so we have some original baths up on this floor. The bathroom you just saw was remodeled in the 1890s.
Could you talk for just a minute about the fireplaces and why every room has one?
Good point. Well, when the house was built, probably the fireplaces were the main source of heat for the house. They would not have had electricity yet. They would have had what was called gas lighting. And then by 1890, they had added electricity to the house. And probably about the same time, they added steam heat. But fireplaces were pretty important for heating the house. And again, this is that mantle that they moved up from downstairs. We're glad they saved it because it's a really cool mantle. The one you just saw was a guest room for the family. This one was also considered a guest room. And we aren't going to step all the way in, but you can come up to the rope. We keep the shades closed now because sunlight can be really hard on furniture and carpets and draperies. So that's why we keep the shades down. But back in the family's period, they would have had those shades up and windows open to bring in some cooler air on hot days. And you would have had a great view on these upper floors looking out towards the Mississippi River. The next room we're going to go into was a sitting room, and it was more the family's private sitting room. Downstairs is where they would have entertained and had guests, but up here, this sitting room was just for the family, for their privacy. Right now, we have about everything moved out because we had a water leak that we're going to repair. But what I set up was a special display of artifacts, items from our collection that may have been gifts to all the family members in this house. For Charles Deere, his wife, his children, and even Charles Wiman. This is a pretty cool movie camera that belonged to Charles Wiman. It's a Victor, and that company started in Davenport and made movie cameras. They like to go fishing. We found some fishing poles of theirs. Even a game that was popular back in the 1920s called Mahjong. A hat that belonged to Charles Deere, and an umbrella. And then one of my favorite things is this little toy stove. It's from 1930. It belonged to Charles Wiman's two daughters, Patricia and Mary Jane. And it was made by the same company that made the Lionel train. They also made these toy stoves, but they were only made these stoves 1 year because they found out that it was a little too dangerous for kids. You plug it in and those burners get hot just like a regular stove. Even the oven could heat up.
What?
So kind of like an early easy bake oven, only a lot hotter. And so they realized it was too dangerous. And then we've got some cool things over here in the trunk. You might talk a little bit about ladies' fans. This is a very ornate fan that belonged to Anna Deere Wiman. Hair combs. Those were popular in the Victorian era for women to put their hair up and they'd wear a hair comb. This bottle's pretty cool. That's a perfume bottle that belonged to Mary Deere. And then down at this end, we've got a toy giraffe that belonged to the Wiman boys, some photos, and an old stereo Opticon, which you can still buy those today, but this is an early style. Now we're going to go through one of the original 1872 bathrooms. They did update this because about 120 years ago, they put this cool shower in. As an exhibit room, but this was really the master bedroom for the Wimans. And we have a display in here of a Lionel train that belonged to Charles Wiman. He purchased it in the early 1930s, same time that probably that he purchased that stove for his children. Now we're going to go across the hallway. This bedroom, the Wimans, when they lived here, it was a guest room. But during the Deere period, this might have been Mary Deere's bedroom. And the furniture dates to when she lived in the house. So 1870s to the turn of the century. Now we're going to go into the last bathroom. Remember I mentioned earlier that 1872, the house did have indoor plumbing, and this was one of the bathrooms. They did add the shower about 120 years ago, and notice how water comes from all different directions. You have one nozzle head straight above, that was called the shampoo spray, the rain spray. Came down, you can rinse out the shampoo. Then you see there's a nozzle on each side. The water coming out hits you where your liver and your kidney were. And they thought that was healthy for your internal organs, the water hitting them. Then the tubing here looks kind of like a rib cage. There's little holes all along there, and there was a real fine spray that came out hitting you all around, and that was called the needle spray. It wasn't like needles, but that real fine spray that they thought that was good for your circulation system, and so your blood, make your blood pump better. So this was really popular with the wealthy. And then we're going to take a look at the elevator. We're going to call the elevator up. It starts in the basement and can come right past us and go all the way to the third floor. Now, the elevator wasn't here in 1872. They didn't have electricity yet, and they didn't have residential elevators yet. But we know that the elevator was here by 1899. And we think that we may have the oldest elevator in the Quad Cities that still works. Now, why do we know 1899? Well, I was doing some research one day about that fire that started up on third floor. And I thought if Charles Deere's house caught on fire, I bet it got written about in the newspapers. So I went to the library and looked at the newspapers of 1899. And I found an article. It said that a hot water heater started the fire up on third floor. But it said that William Wiman, Charles Deere's son-in-law, was the only family member in town that night. He came home, saw the fire, he ran up the stairs to the third floor to see if he could help the firemen. But in all the smoke and noise, it said he fell against a door just like this one on third floor. And when glass gets hot, if you barely touch it, it's gonna shatter. Well, he bumped into it, it shattered, and he fell down the elevator shaft all the way to the basement level. I was so excited that he fell down the elevator shaft. Why? Because if somebody fell down the elevator shaft in 1899 and it's written about in the newspaper, it means they had to have an elevator by 1899. So that's why I like history. Sometimes you find things out in kind of weird ways. But the elevator, we still use it. If the door is open, it's not going to go anywhere. You have to have everything shut to go. Work area. The kitchen, a staff dining room, storage. There was a billiards room down here at one time, but what we're going to do is take a look at the tunnel that connects the house to the carriage house. That was nice, especially in the winter time, so you didn't have to go outside. And that's where the laundry was. It was in the carriage house. But even in the summer, you didn't want to see them trundling laundry across the yard. So they used the tunnel. Thank you. Well, now we're going to walk through the main floor of the Butterworth home. Here's the picture of it as it looked when it was first built in 1892, 20 years after Deere Wiman was built. Charles Deere built this house as a wedding gift for his daughter, Catherine, when she married William Butterworth. Catherine and William never had children, but William became president of Deere & Company when his father-in-law, Charles, died. And so they started adding on to the house so they could entertain larger groups for business and their church and community groups that they worked with. So the house here is how it first looked, but the house today is about three times larger than this house. Okay, let's go into the living room right around the corner here. See now, the size of it was done in 1925. Originally, though, just 1/4 of this room was the living room, and another 1/4 was the dining room, and this half of the room didn't exist. But through a couple of remodelings, they kept enlarging the room. Until 1925, we had this room with the beautiful paneling and ceiling and the pipe organ. Well, this pipe organ, you could play it or you could put a roll on, kind of like a player piano, only it was a player organ. Well, we have it so I can just hit a few buttons and make it play. So I'm going to start the organ and then I'll open the door so you can see inside the organ chamber. And it would seat about 26 people. So the Butterworths entertained a lot. And behind you there, there's a photograph of each Mr. Butterworth and Mrs. Butterworth. Those pictures were taken about 1907 and about the time that he became president of Deere & Company. Okay, we're gonna head into Butler's pantry. Okay. So this butler's pantry is a lot bigger than the one that you saw over at the Deere Wiman house. Again, this shows how much the Butterworths entertained. This is just where the dishes were kept and washed. And notice how they had one of those special sinks here that was good for washing china and crystal. Then into the kitchen. The kitchen was, during the remodelings, this room was built in 1909. Nice big kitchen for all the cooking that had to be done. And there's a few photos above the wall, on the wall there, that shows some of the staff from the 1910s. We know that the Butterworth had a staff of about 20, and that would have included a butler who was in charge of everything in the house. The second butler who assisted the butler, the head housekeeper, maids, cook, assistant cook, two chauffeurs, one for Mr. Butterworth, one for Mrs. Butterworth, a head gardener, gardening staff, probably grew during the summer months, a seamstress who did any sewing that was needed in the house, the laundress who did all the laundry. There was a position called houseman. He did probably the heavier cleaning jobs that the maids couldn't do. And then we also know that Mrs. Butterworth had a live-in secretary for part of the life of the house. So nice big staff, but they needed a big staff. And here we are back to the main entryway. This room was totally remodeled in 1917. There used to be a room here that was the library, a hallway on this side, and an entryway down there at that end, and the staircase going up to the second floor. That's still the same. But they tore all of that out when they built a new library. And so this became a big entryway. So if the Butterworths were entertaining, people would arrive down underneath the what was called the porte cochere, and their chauffeur would drop them off there. They'd come in, the butler would take their coat, and then they'd come up these stairs, and this is where Mr. and Mrs. Butterworth would greet arriving guests. So this great big room, we have it set up for a meeting that's coming up. But when the Butterworths lived here, this was, let me grab the picture here. This is probably the best one to see. This picture shows how this room was decorated by the Butterworths back in the 1950s. It was called the library because of all the bookcases, but it was where there were several seating areas that Butterworths, when they entertained, people could sit in here and talk. So it was beautifully decorated with this beautiful rug and all the furniture and artwork. We still have a few pieces of the artwork and furniture, but we use it as a great big meeting room. But what's really cool is the ceiling painting. But the ceiling painting is about 300 years old. It was painted in Venice, Italy. By a Venetian artist, for a building that still stands in Venice. But the Butterworths purchased the canvas painting from an art dealer who bought it from that building in Venice. They brought it here, the Butterworths bought it, and then told their architect, you need to design a room that fits the size and shape of the ceiling painting. So that's why we have the shape of room we have. And then the Butterworths had stonework done around the doorway, the windows, and the mantle to kind of reflect the period of the painting. Now, we got two paintings. Here's Mr. Butterworth. You saw him as a younger man a little earlier. Here he is older. He was president of Deere Company from 1907 until 1928. Then he was still on the board at Deere and Company until his death in 1936. Down in the far corner, we have a painting of his wife, Catherine Deere Butterworth. We know that she grew up at the Deere Wiman house and then moved to this house when she got married. She lived in this house as a widow until her death in 1953. And so this is where the Butterworths kept their cars. They didn't have carpet, of course, but when the building was first built in 1910, there was a double door there to come in off of 11 and a double door down at the far end to come in off 7. But I think as 7th got busier, they sealed that off and added two sets of doors here. And the Butterworths always had two cars, but they also had kind of all-purpose vehicle that would have hauled luggage to the train station when they were going on trips. And the one thing we've got left that's kind of cool, we've got a little kitchen now, which they didn't have, but this is part of the garage. It's an oil dispenser. And so you had to change the oil in the cars. And so they could drain out the old oil, and then you'd set a can there and you'd pump this to fill your oil can when you needed fresh oil in the car.